Aristotle began to construct a philosophical position sharply distinguished from his master's. His intellectual temperament was one that took the empirical world on its own terms as fully real. True reality, he believed, was the perceptible world of concrete objects, not an imperceptible world of eternal ideas. The theory of ideas seemed to him both empirically unverifiable and fraught with logical difficulties. To counter that theory, Aristotle put forth his doctrine of categories. Things can be said to be in many ways. A tall white horse is in one sense tall, in another sense white, in another sense a horse. Yet these different ways of being are not equivalent in ontological status, for the tallness and whiteness of the horse depend for their existence entirely on the primary reality of the particular horse. The horse is substantial in its reality in a way that the adjectives describing it are not. For Aristotle, the real world is one of individual substances which are distinct and separate from each other, yet which are characterized by qualities or other types of being held in common with other individual substances. A substance, Aristotle concluded, is not simply a unit of matter, but is an intelligible structure or form embodied in matter, although the form is entirely immanent and does not exist independently of its material embodiment, it is the form that gives to the substance its distinctive essence. Yet form for Aristotle was not static, and it was especially here that Aristotle both sustained certain elements of Plato's philosophy and added a fundamentally new dimension. For in Aristotle's view, form gives to a substance not only its essential structure, but also its developmental dynamic. Organic biology, rather than abstract mathematics, was Aristotle's characteristic science. Aristotle taught that an organism moves from an imperfect or immature condition in a teleological development toward achievement of a full maturity in which its inherent form is actualized. The form is an intrinsic principle of operation that is implicit in the organism from the latter's inception, as the form of the oak is implicit to the acorn. It seems that Aristotle regarded the mind not only as that which is activated by sensory experience, but also as something that is eternally active, and indeed divine and immortal. This aspect of mind, the active intellect, nous, gave man the intuitive capacity to grasp final and universal truths. Only because man shares in the divine nous can he apprehend infallible truth, and the nous constitutes the only part of man that comes in from outside. In Aristotle's view, the individual human soul might cease to exist with death, since the soul is vitally joined to the physical body it animates. The soul is the form of the body, just as the body is the matter of the soul. But the divine intellect, of which each man has a potential share, and which distinguishes man from other animals, is immortal and transcendent. Indeed, man's highest happiness consists in the philosophical contemplation of eternal truth. Also like Plato, Aristotle believed the deepest cause for things must be sought not in the beginning of things, but in their end, their telos, their purpose and final actuality, that to which they aspire. Although the Aristotelian forms, with one exception, are wholly immanent in nature and not transcendent, they are essentially changeless and are thus recognizable by the human intellect amidst the flux of organic development and decay. Cognition takes place when the mind receives the form of a substance into itself, even though in the world, that form never exists apart from its particular material embodiment. The mind conceptually separates, or abstracts, what is not separated in reality. Yet because reality possesses inherent structure, cognition is possible. An empirical approach to nature is meaningful because of nature's intrinsic openness to rational description, by which it can be cognitively organized according to forms, categories, causes, genera, species, and the like. Thus Aristotle continued and brought new definition to the Platonic conception of an ordered and humanly knowable cosmos.